When we're covering something up, when we all know we are not confessing something, when we know that we are not giving something over to God, that He is asking us to A, admit to ourselves, then admit to Him, it saps our energy, not just physical, it saps our mental, and it saps our spiritual energy. And when we're quiet before God, when we sit there, we allow Him to talk to us. As we've done already this morning, we allow Him to talk, and He might be pointing things out to us that He's just saying, give that to me.
This is GBC Web TV, on the internet at gbcweb.tv. Welcome to Greenford Baptist Church in West London. Here you can watch inspired biblical teaching and find out how to apply God's Word to your everyday lives. On the website, you can also listen to audio versions of these programs or download them as podcasts.
Please grab a Bible, if you can. Please do grab it. You are going to need one. It's going to be about 15 minutes. You could do probably with your own individual one. Try and not share, because you're going to be spending some time reading it on your own. And it will be good if you had your own Bible. Okay, Psalm 32. Don't start reading it yet, but let me talk to you. Do we believe that God talks to us today?
Yes.
And a bit louder.
Yes.
Good. Do we believe that God talks to us individually?
Yes.
Do you believe you can hear... Thank you, Steve. Do you believe you can hear God for yourself?
Yes.
Okay. That's what you're going to do this morning. You know, normally when David or anybody here does some teaching, it's always done interactive, asking the questions. Yeah? It's going to be really interactive because you're going to be interacting directly with God the Father, which we do anyway, but you're going to be doing it on your own. Okay? We're going to be doing something that's not quite, but almost called Lectio Divina, which is a really flash Latin way of saying divine reading, which is, again, a really flash way of saying reading the Bible, listening to God at the same time, and allowing the Word of God to speak to us. Yeah? Do we believe the Word of God is authoritative?
Yes.
And God can talk to us through His Word?
Yes.
It is authoritative. Something else I want to mention where I go and talk at the Grange is when we're singing songs and speaking, they can be a little bit rowdy. They like to say their own thing, the residents there at there, and they're great though, and they want to say their own thing. But the minute I start reading from the Bible, there is silence. Seriously, I've noted it over the time, and Joan comes with me, and so does Genevieve, and there is silence. That's how authoritative the Word of God is. The minute they know I am reading from the Bible, and they can, there is silence. So God does talk to us through that. So anyways, as I said, this divine reading, it's a way of, there's a few ways of doing it, but it will be reading this and then reading it again slowly and again slowly. And maybe again, slowly, allowing the words to sink into you. Allowing them to meditate in your heart and in your mind. And then in the process of that, it's allowing you, God, to speak to you through it. Okay? Everybody with me so far? A lot of you probably already do this. Do this at various points. But we're going to do that. I feel this is what God wants us to do this morning. He wants us to all participate in actively engaging and listening to Him for ourselves. There's also going to be absolutely no music during the time or any sound in the background whilst we're meditating for 15 minutes. Seems a long time. But when you're with God and you're reading something over and over, it's not that long at all. So I have discovered over the months that I've really started to do it. Everyone with me so far? Yeah, because we really want to hear God. Music's great, even instrumental music that appears to have no words that we're aware of. But what it can do is guide our thinking and not allow God to guide our thinking when we're reading his word. So I want us to try that. It's warm, I know. I'm sure we can stay. I'm going to read this just for a moment. No, I'm not. Let's pray. Let's just talk to God for a moment. Lord, Heavenly Father, we know that you have been and you are always present with us. Lord, we know by your Spirit you are here. And that's true for each and every one of us, Lord, that you are here by your Spirit. And I thank you. Whether we know you or whether we don't yet, Lord, you are still here because you're actively always trying to get our attention. You're actively always trying to intervene into our lives and be part of them. So, Lord, this morning I pray for each and every one of us as we read your word, as we meditate upon your word, as we allow your word to soak in, as we allow you to talk to us about us through your word. Lord, I ask by your Spirit that you will just engage everyone and engage with us and interact with us, Lord, in the only unique way that you as Father can. In the name of Jesus, amen. I'm going to read this slowly, and then you can then read it to yourself three or four times. I do recommend slow reading through it for yourself. And then after 15 minutes or so, when I call us back, we're then going to look through it all together, okay? As always with the masculine, put the feminine there if you wish. Blessed is he whose transgressions are forgiven, whose sins are covered. Blessed is the man whose sin the Lord does not count against him, and in whose spirit is no deceit. When I kept silent, my bones wasted away through my groaning all day long. For day and night, your hand was heavy upon me. My strength was sapped as in the heat of summer. Then I acknowledged my sin to you and did not cover up my iniquity. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and you forgave the guilt of my sin. Therefore, let everyone who is godly pray to you while you may be found. Surely when the mighty waters rise, they will not reach him. You are my hiding place. You will protect me from trouble and surround me with songs of deliverance. I will instruct you and teach you in the way you should go. I will counsel you and watch over you. Do not be like the horse or the mule, which have no understanding, but must be controlled by bit and bridle, or they will not come to you. Many are the woes of the wicked, but the Lord's unfailing love surrounds the man who trusts in him. Rejoice in the Lord and be glad, you righteous. Sing, all you who are upright in heart. Okay, if you'd like to start slowly bringing yourself back. What was that? Hard? Easy? Strange? Strange, yeah. Something actually most of us should be doing most of the times. It says, you know, in Psalm 1, I meditate upon your laws. Meditate means literally that. That's the start of what we've just done there. I'd like you to turn into twos and threes. And if you want to, just briefly talk about what you felt. Just for a moment, just talk to some other people next to you. Just say what you felt. Don't have to say what God said to you, that I'm not asking for. But just, you know, just say how you felt. You need to be honest about it, so I'd just like you to do that, just for a moment, please. Okay, I'd like to bring your conversations to a close. And we're going to work through this now. Start looking at some of this together. Okay? Everybody can hear me? Sorry, one of the back amps at the back has blown, so the back set of speakers aren't working this morning, so we apologise for that. Let's just bring you back. Let's work through this. Just to let you know, by the way, if you found that sort of a stretch in the last 5 minutes or the last whatever, you only lasted actually 10 minutes. I didn't go for the full 15. Just a bit of interest for you. We only went on for 10 minutes. Let's look at this. Well, as it says in the Bible, Psalm 32, it's more than likely of King David. And this psalm is actually an expression of the joy of being forgiven. Yeah? And that's what it is. It's an expression of the joy of being forgiven by God. And David understood that joy even prior to Jesus dying on the cross and being risen again. But he understood that joy. He understood that he could be forgiven by God. A great word, blessed, is in there. And I don't know if you remember, but back to when I done a sermon on the Beatitudes, blessed means happy. Because God's kingdom's broken through and he's resting upon you. So in verses 1 and 2, we have, blessed is he whose transgressions are forgiven, whose sins are covered. Covered by what, though? Covered up? Or covered by? God's grace. Not covered up. Covered by God's grace. Blessed is the man whose sin the Lord does not count against him, and in whose spirit is no deceit. Funnily enough, that word, whose spirit is no deceit, is in the book of John, verse 1:47. There's a point where Jesus turns to Nathanael. You can look at it if you wish. This is just when he sort of first meets John. It's John, keep your finger in Psalm 32. It's John chapter 1, verse 47. I think it's 1064 in the... I think that's the page number in the red. I think. Yes? Good. I'm glad this Bible does match the red ones. And it says, when Jesus saw Nathanael approaching, he said to him, here is a true Israelite in whom there is nothing false. It's translated exactly the same. It is about the fact that there is no deceit within him. Doesn't mean that he was sinless. There was no deceit in him. He was honest about everything. So back to Psalm 32. There is no deceit. Well, what can deceit be? I don't know what got drawn out for you as you was reading this. I'm not saying for me personally it struck about deceit in my spirit, but it was something I felt that needed to be drawn out this morning. So, anybody? What could that be? Anna.
It could be that sometimes you're convicted of something and you still say you don't think it's wrong and you don't tell God about it. I don't know how to explain it better.
No, that's fine. So you're convicted of something, but you're denying that conviction and you're saying, no, God, what I'm doing is nothing wrong at all. Yep, very good. Fiona.
Motivated to act from the wrong motives. Kind of like you're doing something good, but you're not doing it from what God wants you to do it. You're doing it because of different motives.
Motivated by wrong, wrong acts. You're motivated to do something through falseness.
Yeah.
Maybe to be look good or to whatever, to get some credit. Anybody else? That's interesting. My phone's ringing in the office. What deceit could there be? What's deceit in the spirit? Yes, it could be this double-mindedness. I've got self-denial of a problem. But deceit could be anything. Deceit in the spirit. It doesn't have to necessarily be a sin. It is a sin to have a deceit in your spirit. But what is that deceit? What is it, the things that we are covering up? It's very easy to cover things up, isn't it? Well, it is with fellow human beings, but it's not with God. It could be deceit that your working hours, you're not holding true to them. During the hours, you're skiving off slightly. Yeah? David, I'm not. I am working diligently. My hours are true. Could be that deceit. But yeah, I like the one that Anna said the most, which would mean you are denying something that God is convicting you of. You're saying, no, Lord, what I'm doing is okay. But actually God is saying, no, it's not. It's not okay. And God is sitting there saying, no, really, this is something that you need to give to me. And you're letting that sit in your spirit, and you are covering it up. You're denying it. And God is saying, no, really, don't do that. This is something I need you to listen to. This is something I need you to bring to me. But we carry on our walk. We carry on praising God. We carry on praying. We've actually got something in our lives that God is saying, no, this is wrong. Bring it to me. So what is the consequences of that? Let's carry on reading to what David was saying about his transgressions, the thing that was not sitting right with him. This entire time of no deceit does not mean you're sinless, but there could be a habitual sin, an ongoing thing you're doing that God is now saying, that's it. I need you to be truthful with me about this. So carry on, verses 3 and 4. When I kept silent, my bones wasted away through my groaning all day long. For day and night your hand was heavy upon me, my strength was sapped as in the heat of summer. I don't know about you lot, but when there are things that have been in my life that I know that God has called me to deal with, I've tried to deny them for ages. And I find that I wake up in the morning with it on my mind. I find up I go to sleep with it on my mind. And through the rest of the day, it sits there with me, inside of me, gnawing away at me. Like a dog can gnaw away at a bone. And it can just sit there. And I can keep denying it. I spend my time and my strength on trying to suppress that I know that God is saying, deal with it. Does anybody else had the same experience? Thank you. One honest person. A few honest people. Okay. And we do that, don't we? And we find our strength is getting sapped away. Yeah? We find we actually concentrate more on that than actually living our life for God and living our lives full stop. And it's true. I love what David said here. My strength was sapped as in the heat of summer. Now, it's warm today. Yes? If you're wearing a suit, how hot does it really feel right now? Believe you me, I don't want to take this off at the moment, but I am feeling Let me go and lay down for a while. Let me go and get my shorts and t-shirt on. I could do with it. But I do. I feel slightly sapped of strength. And I'm not really doing anything active, other than standing up here. When we're covering something up, when we know we are not confessing something, when we know that we are not giving something over to God, that he is asking us to A, admit to ourselves, then admit to him, it saps our energy, not just physical, it saps our mental, and it saps our spiritual energy. And when we're quiet before God, when we sit there, we allow him to talk to us. As we've done already this morning, we allow him to talk, and he might be pointing things out to us that he's just saying, give that to me. Now, I want to remind you again, this psalm is a psalm of the joy of forgiveness, not the misery of condemnation. It's a big difference. But the two are balanced. We do, not condemnation, but conviction. We do need to balance the two and know that our God does convict us. It's not always about being happy-clappy. The Old Testament's full of it. There were times I was saying, Lord, why? And God's saying, well, you're not doing what I want you to do. But please remember, this is David going, oh, I have been forgiven. So you might well have got that. When you was meditating, you really picked up on the fact this was about a joy of forgiveness. Some of us might have picked up, maybe it's not. Not at the moment. Something here that God is saying to me about deceit in my spirit. There's something I need to acknowledge. Let's carry on. Let's carry on now looking at what David did do with this and hence how he could write this psalm. Then I acknowledged my sin to you and did not cover up my iniquity. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord. And what's his next response? And you forgave the guilt of my sin. Well, there's a release. It wasn't, I confessed my transgressions and then you asked me to, I have to go and do a load of penance. I have to go and do community service. He actually stated, you forgave the guilt of my sin. There's an instant there. Did you see that, everyone? But it's the guilt. It's the guilt of the sin. Doesn't mean the sin itself has, the consequences of the sin has gone away, but the guilt of it has. There are some sins that are in our, that we have committed, unfortunately, that do have consequences, long-term consequences. Can have long-term damage. You know, it could be having an affair that then ends up breaking up marriages. Pregnancy outside of it, outside of marriage, you know, that produces children and they have a long-term life that you need to look after and spend time with. It doesn't just disappear, but the guilt of it does when you confess those to God. I'm just picking on a few. There's plenty of others. But God does forgive our guilt when we confess it to him, when we try not to cover it up. But why do we need to cover up these sins? Why do we need to cover up these sins? Why do we need to confess these sins? Why do we need to give them up to God? Why do we can't we just have that as cover that up, that little bit of deceit? I'll keep that going. I don't need to worry about that. Because there's something else that happens when we're covering something up, if we're trying to keep it buried and we're not trying to give it to God and we're not trying to release that conviction that God has given us of that. And that means our armour is dented. Satan has a foothold. And let's read about that. It says 6 and 7. Therefore, let everyone who is godly pray to you while you may be found. Surely, when the mighty waters rise, they will not reach him. Let's just look at that. This is David saying, actually, God, while you can be found, let everybody turn to you. Let everybody pray to you. Let everybody acknowledge you. Because a day is coming when that will be it. Jesus will return, and that will be it. You won't be able to turn. You will turn. Everybody will bow down and acknowledge that he is Lord. But at that point, if you've, depending on which way you've made your decision, if you decided to follow Jesus or you've decided not to, you've made your decision. So David is saying here, even prior to then, why God can be found, those are the godly, let's turn to him. That's God saying, just because there's something I'm convicting you of, does not mean you can't turn to me and give it to me. Turn to me. And surely when the mighty waters rise, they will not reach him. Mighty waters there is a signification of God's, because the Israelites did not like the large expanse of water. They felt there was big living evil creatures in there, and it really did scare them. Almost like a version of hell, I would suggest. None of us like the idea of going to hell, do we? No. And if this is like hell breaking out as such, if this is Satan coming on for the attack on a Christian, on a godly person, there is deceit within your spirit that you know that you have not confessed to God. It can get at you. That's an area where they can get in and take you down. They can wash over you. Because it's an area that undermines your life, that you know you should confess to God. It comes up at times of when you're ministering to people or you're praying or you're doing sort of, you know you're exceptionally, you're out there really doing God's work. And it could be a dent that Satan goes, well, how can you be doing anything for God? Because you've got this in your life. I know that you have. And you've not given it to God. So God's not going to use you. Now, that's not strictly true, because that's the case. None of us be used, because all of us have stuff in our life that's not right. We all have sins. And God, at each time, works on them with us. Picks on everyone. But we are covered by the grace of Jesus. So God does use us. So God will use you at the carnival. God will use those of envisioned tonight to speak to people that are coming tonight. Not just in the prophetic, but in every area of your life. Be it administration skills. If you've got the gift of administration, God can use you in that. God does use us. But it's very easy if we come under, if Satan wants to take us down, if he wants to keep us nicely suppressed, there's something that's deceitful in our spirit that we know we should be handing over to God. He can use that just to keep us nicely down. So David continues, you are my hiding place. You will protect me from trouble and surround me with songs of deliverance. Hallelujah. I like the idea of the fact that God can surround me with songs of deliverance. Yeah? Yes? Oh, I just think that's great. That makes me feel brilliant. That's the same for all of us. But prior to that, we have to confess some of our transgressions. We have to confess stuff that we know that God is saying to us. And we can really experience that songs of deliverance. Really experience it. Because again, this psalm, I must remind, is about the joy of being forgiven. And that is must be an inexpressible joy. To know that there are songs being sung around us. That brings a joy that nothing on this earth that God or man has created, can possibly bring. Yes? But the way our society works and the way that man works, it doesn't really matter too much. Don't worry about that little thing. It's legal in this country, so therefore then don't worry about it, whatever that could be. There's some stuff in our society that's legal, but in God's eyes, it's not legal. And God says, confess that to me, bring that to me. Shouts of songs of deliverance will surround. You will be released from the heat of the summer that's sapping your strength at this time. So David's confessed it. He's hearing these songs of deliverance. And in verses definitely 8 to 10, this is God speaking. Because it was in humility that David had to come to God and confess. It was in acknowledgement that he's sinful. And God says, I will instruct you and teach you in the way you should go. I will counsel you and watch over you. Now, in years gone by, I would have probably read that and gone, God watching over me? Oh, dear. Quick hide. But when you really read that, and I'm sure when you meditated and read that, I'm hoping all of us got a real sense of, amen, my Father is watching over me. For those who don't know, I have a daughter who's 6 3/4 now. I better not say 6 1/2, it upsets her. She's 6 3/4, and I watch over her because I don't like seeing her get into trouble. I don't like seeing her make mistakes. But I also watch over her because I like seeing when she does things new. I like watching over her when I see her grow. Grow in listening to me occasionally. Very occasionally. Anybody with daughters of that age or even sons of that age, you'll all go, yeah, we know what it's like. But when I see that, when I see my daughter grow, when I see her develop, when I see her come and just be who she's meant to be, slowly but surely, I love watching that. I smile. And God does the same with us. When he's watching over us, when he's counseling us, when he's guiding us, it's because he wants us to be the people we are meant to be in him. Does that sound good? Unfortunately, it does mean sometimes with Keris, I do have to tell her when she's wrong. And I have to say, stop doing that. And of course, my daughter instantly listens and instantly stops exactly what she's doing. Not. Thank you, Andy. Absolutely. She'll come back later and do it again. And again. And again. And again and again and again. There is something I really have got to stop her doing. I'm not going to explain what it is. But she continues, even though I keep saying, stop doing it. And I initially am calm in saying it. And then a bit later on, I raise my voice. Those that know me sometimes know I go from 0 to 60 fast. But, you know, I do raise my voice. And then I get a little bit louder. And then I start shouting. Yet she still disobeys. And still does not listen. And still continues until eventually maybe an accident occurs, she gets injured. And then there's a consequence. She's got bruising. Actually, 3 years ago or so, she lost a tooth completely. It's still gone. She hasn't, the second one hasn't grown through yet because she did not listen. And it continues. Does not the same go with us, though? We all laugh about my daughter. But can we sit there and say, actually, maybe God sometimes is shouting at us? And we are still steadfastly carrying on doing what we want to do. We're still being children. And we're meant to be children of God. But we're also meant to be listening children and obeying children. So God continues with David. Says, because I'm watching over you. But it's this, and this is what I'm talking about. God says this. Do not be like the horse or the mule, which have no understanding, but must be controlled by bit and bridle, or they will not come to you. Are you being a horse or a mule? It's not a nice description to be classed as. But sometimes we need to hear the harsh words to get our attention. Just like my daughter, just like Keris, I want to see her grow. I want her to become the person she needs to be. I don't want her running out into the street as the car suddenly comes past. So sometimes I have to grab her and yank her towards me. Now, it may look quite violent almost, but it's the best thing for her. It's the best thing for a horse and a mule if they have to be controlled, to be brought near to the rider, to be brought near to their owner. And this is what God is saying. Don't be like that. Be like the obeying child. Be like someone who wants to spend time with the Father, who wants me counselling them, watching over them. But if you're really feeling that tug, if you're really feeling there's a pull on you, it's because God wants you close to you, close to Him. And He's saying, I don't want to keep having to pull. I, with Keris, don't want to have to keep going, come on, come on. God doesn't want to always do that, neither. I'd like Keris, if she ever watches these later in life, she's probably really going to have a go at me if I keep using her, but, you know, if I want her to stay with me and beside my side naturally, that's what I really want. I want to be able to walk with her and talk with her and converse with her without having to feel like I need to keep saying, don't do that, don't do that. Our Father is the same with us. If He's got something that's convicting you of, He wants you to be truthful with Him, give it to Him. Don't keep pulling away from Him. And God continues, many are the woes of the wicked, but the Lord's unfailing love surrounds the man who trusts in Him. It's not about being sinless. It's about trusting God that God knows best. And so therefore then it's about giving it to Him. And God will be with us. God always promises to be with us. But you could always get that. Sometimes we get that feeling that God is not with us. He's far away from us and we feel distant. God says, if you're really honest with me and walk with me honestly, I'll be with you all the time. And then 11 says, rejoice in the Lord and be glad, you righteous. Sing, all you who are upright in heart. And that upright in heart, to me, goes back to verse 2, in whose spirit is no deceit. It must be hard. I know I found it hard before now to sit here on a Sunday or during a Tuesday or on a Wednesday to sit here and worship God. To sing songs to Him when I know there's something I should really be giving up to Him. I know there's something I'm covering up. It's very hard to feel upright in heart before God. When God is saying, confess this to me, bring this to me. It's not about being perfect. None of us can be perfect. It's through Jesus that we are made perfect in God's sight. None of us can be perfect. But there are times, there's times in my life, and there's times in people's lives here, in everybody's life here, and there's times probably now, today, that God is saying, be honest, be truthful. There's something about in your life that I'm asking you to hand over to me, to confess to me, so that I can deal with it. We can be honest about our feelings with God as well. You can actually turn around to God and say, but I don't want to give that up. You need to be honest sometimes with God. God does like us to be honest with Him. He does know, but He likes us to be honest with ourselves and then with Him. And then there's this release and this joy of forgiveness, which is what inspired David to write this psalm. He was released from the guilt of his sin. And he went, wow, I've got more strength. I can wear a suit without feeling too hot. I'm not feeling sapped of energy. I am waking up in peace and going to sleep in peace because I know my Father is watching over me and counselling me. I just want everybody now just to sit. If you need to reread that psalm, do so. Again, no music. Let's let God, we don't need music. God likes to speak to us. It's good to worship God with music. It's good to sing songs to him. But it's also good to be able to do that without music, which I believe you all experienced last week. But in quiet contemplation, God likes to talk to us as well. So if you know, as I've been speaking, as you meditated for those 10 minutes right at the beginning, that God was saying something about giving something to him, give that to him now. If it was also about actually you need to acknowledge that you are blessed by God because of your forgiveness and it's something you've not taken on board before. Really, truly taken on board the fact that actually you are forgiven. I ask you to give that to God now and ask him to really show that to you. Let's just pray. Father, I thank you for your grace and your mercy. Father, I thank you that you watch over us with the love of a father. Lord, I thank you that you want the best for us. You want us to grow in you. I thank you, Lord, that there are times when you say, what you're doing is not the best. It's not healthy. It's not what I want for you. And Lord, I thank you that you talk to us calmly at times, and other times, Lord, you do shout at us because you need to get our attention. Lord, I pray for each and every one of us where you have spoken to us in our spirit this morning. Lord, I ask you help us by your spirit to give those things to you and for us to acknowledge the fact that we are released of the guilt of the sin. The Lord, that each of us can be upright in our spirit with you. Lord, I also pray for us, those of us that have not understood that joy of forgiveness. We've not understand and understood fully and not accepted that we are forgiven in you. That we are blessed. We are happy because we have been forgiven. Lord, ask by your Spirit that you will talk to each and every one of us about that. In the name of Jesus, amen.
We do hope you've enjoyed and benefited from this presentation. To learn more about what the Bible teaches us and how to apply this to our everyday lives, check out our biblical teaching and other videos at gbcweb.tv.